This is Duke University.
I greet you in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Welcome to University Worship at Duke Chapel this morning. I have two announcements and then one special welcome. The first one is to emphasize that today we have the 40th annual crop walk, which will be beginning on the steps of the chapel at 2:30 p.m. And the crop walk really is a walk, a fight against hunger, and all are welcome to participate in that this afternoon. The second announcement I want to highlight is that the congregation is hosting a special potluck lunch after service in the basement for all young adults. If you self-define as a young adult, you're welcome to come, and I hear there's going to be pork barbecue. I'm not sure if it's Eastern or the Western barbecue, but it's going to be a wonderful time of fellowship, and so I wanted to highlight that. And last but not least, we have our special guest preacher today who is no stranger to us, the Bishop William Willimon, who is our distinguished Goodson preacher. Bishop Willimon served for 20 years as dean of the chapel here. I'm not sure if I was born during that time, but he had one of the longest tenures here at Duke Chapel in that role, and so it's a blessing to have him with us, and it's a privilege to count him as a colleague and friend. This is the day that the Lord has made. So let us rejoice and be glad in it, even as we sing our opening hymn, "Out of the Depths I Cry to You, O Lord." So would you please stand as we begin our worship?
Thank you. Out of the depths of our sins and failings, we turn to God, for there is no other place to turn. We seek God, for it is in God we find our hope. Trusting God's mercy and grace, let us pray. Eternal God, we turn to you, knowing there are many ways we have turned away from you, from our neighbors, and even from ourselves. We find ourselves caught in patterns which we cannot change by ourselves, and we are pulled in directions which too often lead us away from you. Help us to return to you and draw us closer to yourself. When we set our minds on the flesh and turn from your spirit, Lord, have mercy. When we refuse to wait for your promised mercies, Christ, have mercy. When we no longer dare to hope in the new life you can bring, Lord, have mercy. Hear us, O Lord, for we seek your healing mercy, and it is in your name we pray. Amen. In the valley of the dry bones, God asked Ezekiel, "Can these bones live?" It seems to me almost a dare to hope that life can come out of death and that hope can come from despair. Friends, in the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus Christ, we have reason for hope. The power of sin and death is broken forever, and we are offered new life. Friends, hear and believe this good news of the gospel. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. As forgiven people, reconciled to God, let us turn to one another to share that peace with one another.
Please join me in the prayer for illumination, printed in your bulletin. Gracious Father, you gave up your Son out of love for the world. As your word is read in our midst, lead us to ponder the mysteries of his passion, that we may know eternal peace through the shedding of our Savior's blood, Jesus Christ our Lord. The Old Testament lesson is from Ezekiel, the 37th chapter. The hand of the Lord came upon me, and he brought me out by the Spirit of the Lord and set me down in the middle of a valley. It was full of bones. He led me all around them. There were very many in the valley, and they were very dry. He said to me, "Mortal, can these bones live?" I answered, "O Lord God, you know." Then he said to me, "Prophesy to these bones and say to them, 'O dry bones, hear the word of the Lord. Thus says the Lord God to these bones, I will cause breath to enter you and you shall live. I will lay sinews on you and will cause flesh to come upon you and cover you with skin and put breath in you and you shall live and you shall know that I am the Lord.' So I prophesied as I had been commanded. And as I prophesied, suddenly there was a noise, a rattling, and the bones came together, bone to its bone. I looked, and there were sinews on them, and flesh had come upon them, and skin had covered them, but there was no breath in them. Then he said to me, Prophesy to the breath, prophesy, mortal, and say to the breath, thus says the Lord God, come from the four winds, O breath, and breathe upon these slain, that they may live. I prophesied as he commanded me, and the breath came into them, and they lived, and stood on their feet, a vast multitude. Then he said to me, mortal, these bones are the whole house of Israel. They say, our bones are dried up, and our hope is lost. We are cut off completely. Therefore, prophesy and say to them, thus says the Lord God, I am going to open your graves and bring you up from your graves, O my people, and I will bring you back to the land of Israel. And you shall know that I am the Lord, when I open your graves and bring you up from your graves, O my people. I will put my spirit within you, and you shall live, and I will place you on your own soil. Then you shall know that I, the Lord, have spoken and will act, says the Lord. This is the word of the Lord. The New Testament lesson is from Romans, the 8th chapter. To set the mind on the flesh is death, but to set the mind on the spirit is life and peace. For this reason, the mind that is set on the flesh is hostile to God. It does not submit to God's law. Indeed, it cannot. And those who are in the flesh cannot please God. But you are not in the flesh. You are in the Spirit, since the Spirit of God dwells in you. Anyone who does not have the Spirit of Christ does not belong to him. But if Christ is in you, though the body is dead because of sin, the Spirit is life because of righteousness. If the Spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, he who raised Christ from the dead will give you life to your mortal bodies, also through his Spirit that dwells in you. This is the word of the Lord.
The gospel lesson is from John, the 11th chapter. Now a certain man was ill, Lazarus of Bethany, the village of Mary and her sister Martha. Mary was the one who anointed the Lord with perfume and wiped his feet with her hair. Her brother Lazarus was ill. So the sisters sent a message to Jesus, "Lord, he whom you love is ill." But when Jesus heard it, he said, "This illness does not lead to death. Rather, it is for God's glory, so that the Son of God may be glorified through it." Accordingly, though Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus, after having heard that Lazarus was ill, he stayed 2 days longer in the place where he was. Then after this, he said to the disciples, "Let us go to Judea again." After saying this, he told them, "Our friend Lazarus has fallen asleep, but I am going there to awaken him." The disciples said to him, "Lord, if he has fallen asleep, he will be all right." Jesus, however, had been speaking about his death, but they thought that he was referring merely to sleep. Then Jesus told them plainly, "Lazarus is dead. For your sake, I am glad I was not there, so that you may believe. But let us go to him." Thomas, who is called the twin, said to his fellow disciples, "Let us also go, that we may die with him." When Jesus arrived, he found that Lazarus had already been dead in the tomb 4 days. Now Bethany was near Jerusalem, some 2 miles away, and many of the Jews had come to Martha and Mary to console them about their brother. When Martha heard that Jesus was coming, she went and met him, while Mary stayed at home. Martha said to Jesus, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But even now, I know that God will give you whatever you ask of him." Jesus said to her, "Your brother will rise again." Martha said to him, "I know that he will rise again in the resurrection on the last day." Jesus said to her, "I am the resurrection and the life. Those who believe in me, even though they die, will live. And everyone who lives and believes in me will never die. Do you believe this?" She said to him, "Yes, Lord, I believe that you are the Messiah, the Son of God, the one coming into the world." When Mary came where Jesus was and saw him, she knelt at his feet and said to him, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died." When Jesus saw her weeping, and the Jews who came with her also weeping, he was greatly disturbed in spirit and deeply moved. He said, "Where have you laid him?" They said to him, "Lord, come and see." Jesus began to weep. So the Jews said, "See how he loved him." But some of them said, "Could not he who opened the eyes of the blind man have kept this man from dying?" Then Jesus, again greatly disturbed, came to the tomb. It was a cave, and a stone was lying against it. Jesus said, "Take away the stone." Martha, the sister of the dead man, said to him, "Lord, already there is a stench, because he has been dead 4 days." Jesus said to her, "Did I not tell you that if you believed, you would see the glory of God?" So they took away the stone. And Jesus looked upward and said, "Father, I thank you for having heard me. I knew that you always hear me, but I have said this for the sake of the crowd standing here, so that they may believe that you sent me." When he had said this, he cried with a loud voice, "Lazarus, come out!" The dead man came out, his hands and feet bound with strips of cloth, and his face wrapped in a cloth. Jesus said to them, "Unbind him and let him go." This is the word of the Lord.
It's a joy to be here in the name of Bishop Kenneth Goodson. He preached the sermon back in 1984 that welcomed us to Duke Chapel. And when I was elected bishop, I was given the robe that Bishop Goodson wore in Alabama during his courageous acts in the 1960s. I wore that robe all over Alabama. It was a magic robe. I figured if it kept them from killing him when he was bishop, it would protect me, and it did. Here I am. Anyone who is still standing, who worked with me at Duke Chapel, can testify, I am not a patient person. Though at times, Dr. Weinkoop's demeanor made me look serene. However, today's gospel has something that it has a detail in there that I think takes an impatient person to note. Today's gospel, Mary and Martha, good buddies of Jesus, come and they say, "Lord, Lazarus, whom you love, is ill. Come quickly." And Jesus sort of brushes it off. He says, "Oh, it's not a sickness unto death. Well, 3 days later, when he gets there to Bethany, he was wrong. Lazarus is dead. Martha comes out and she gives Jesus a piece of her mind. Lord, if you, Mr. Compassion, if you had gotten over here in time, it's too late now. He's dead. He's been entombed for 3 days. Or in the elegant King James, already he stinketh. Jesus, with a loud voice, Lazarus, arise, unbind him, let him go. And Lazarus comes forth. Well, all's well that ends well. But still, my eye falls on a detail. It says that when Mary and Martha sought Jesus for emergency medical assistance for their brother Lazarus, John says Jesus stayed where he was 2 more days. Excuse me? Jesus is summoned in a matter of life and death, and he hangs out where he was 2 more days? I mean, John doesn't say he was in the middle of an important sermon series, he couldn't break away. He doesn't say he was doing medical triage, he had 1,000 people sicker than Lazarus, ahead of Lazarus. All John says is he just stayed there 2 more days. We are told that Jesus is best friends with these people. I ask you, isn't that your definition of a good friend? A good friend is someone who drops whatever he's doing and rushes to your aid when you call. And yet John says, Jesus just stayed there 2 more days. Don't you find this 72-hour hiatus very odd? Am I the only impatient one who notes this? The church fathers worked on this and said, well, you see, the raising of Lazarus is a prefigurement of the raising of Jesus. That's why this is read a couple of weeks before Easter. Get it? Lazarus was in the tomb 3 days, and Jesus was in the tomb 3 days. But then that begs the question, why did Jesus stay in the tomb 3 days? Why this 3-day lacuna between his brutal crucifixion and his resurrection? Why wouldn't he just resurrect it immediately? Why did he put his followers through all that grief and that disillusionment and pain for 3 days? Well, the church fathers had an explanation for that. They said that during those 3 days, Jesus was entombed. He went down and he preached to the spirits in Hades, those who couldn't hear Jesus when, during his earthly ministry, he preached to them, led them out of Hades. The women run back from the tomb on Easter morning, and they say, the tomb is empty, he is risen. And the church has asked, well, where was he those 3 days? What was he doing? Why the wait? Why the delay? I guess it would take an impatient person like me to settle on this. In my first congregation, old folks would sometimes say, they had a saying, God is good all the time. And then people would respond, all the time, God is good. Well, if that's true, how come a 3-day delay? How come God takes time to be good? I believe not only that God is love, I believe God is love pro nobis for us. But why the wait to be love for us? Why in the spiritual life are these vast empty spaces? Why so much wasted time and hopeless despair and unanswered questions? Why delayed salvation if God is God for us? We don't want God simply to be God for us. We want God to be God for us now. And goodness that is goodness postponed can be the most difficult kind. I remember the day it hit me that the time from when Israel went into Egyptian slavery to when, during the Exodus, God delivered Israel from Egyptian slavery was 400 years. You know, in Exodus 3, God comes in the burning bush. He says to Moses, "I have heard the cry of my people. I have come down to deliver them from everything that Pharaoh is doing to them. I have heard I am going to deliver them." And though this is not found in your Bibles, I know Moses said, "Well, Lord, don't rush right over, okay? We've been slaves down here for 400 years. I know somebody who has prayed to God every day for the past 3 decades to deliver her from the painful and crippling arthritis that she suffers. And she, as of this date, has heard nothing. Thus, Stanley Hauerwas says, Israel is a name for that people that learned to let God be God, that learned that they weren't in control of their own history. And when you think about it, that's not a bad definition of the Christian life. Long-term training in allowing our time to be out of our control and in the hands of God. That's what I think about when I hear that phrase, sovereignty of God, sovereignty of God. I don't think about God's omnipotence, God can do anything God wants to do. No, I think about sovereignty in the sense of God's sovereign freedom to be for us, but in God's own good time. I know in my attempt to be bishop in Alabama, any of my flock there would tell you that a major weakness in my leadership was my impatience. I rushed things. I did not allow a crisis to ripen before I jumped into the middle of it. I so wanted our efforts at church renewal to bear fruit now. I so wanted every pastor's ministry to become invigorated now. I made some mistakes that way. I remember a pastor saying to me when I was leaning on him, asking him, did he know when he might become more productive in his ministry? And he said to me, "Hey, Bishop, the way I figured, from the last things God said in the Old Testament to the next time God said anything worth writing down in the New Testament, that had to be at least 400 years. So we can wait 2 more years for you to leave Alabama, okay?" We Methodists are big on grace. The word grace means gift, but it isn't grace if it's on demand, if it's predictable. That's not grace. And maybe that's why sometimes God takes time to move, to reach out, to intervene, to act. She said to me, "Sadly, my son, whom you know, who grew up in Duke Chapel, sadly, as an adult, he's not a believer. He's an atheist." And I, having had experience waiting on God, I said, "Hey, really what you ought to say is, he's not a Christian yet. God's got ways. You tell your son, as he moves into his 40s, he needs to keep looking over his shoulder. Because God can show up anytime God pleases." The Thessalonians ask Paul, "How come Jesus hasn't returned? We're worn out from waiting." And Jesus replied, God is eternal. Paul said, with the Lord, a 1,000 years are just like one day. Okay. Maybe that's why a cardinal Christian virtue is the virtue of patience. And I'll define patience as the willingness to let God be God in God's own good time. Our lives are not under our soul control. We live on God's time, not ours. And maybe that applies not only in life, but also in death. It is conventional at the time of someone's death for mourners to say, "I am sure that my loved one is now with God in heaven." And that may be the case, but the historic Orthodox Christianity has more traditionally said that when we die, we wait. The dead wait. The dead lie in state, awaiting the last trumpet, awaiting the general resurrection. The dead wait, just like Lazarus waited in the tomb. We wait. Maybe our waiting for God in life is therefore a kind of training to fall back on the everlasting arms in death and wait for God. Because maybe the last pope was right when he said, "Only God has a future." We don't have a future without the love of God. A frequently asked question of me when I was exiting as bishop was, "What do you think will be your chief legacy?" And I responded in all seriousness, "Well, God only knows." And I was serious, because legacy is God's self-assigned task. We have nothing within us to give ourselves a future. Only God can do that. Maybe we're made to wait in order for God to purge us of our arrogant urge to take our lives in our own hands and make them turn out right on our terms. Maybe God waits in order to cure us of our godly impatience against letting God be God in time. Maybe we gotta wait because maybe God is up to more than simply righting a few injustices or soothing of some pain. If it's a new heaven and a new earth, if it's creation brought to completion and renovation, maybe it's it's going to take a while. And I don't like to wait. When I go to Dr. Jim Kelly for my health care, or as I define it, immortality therapy, there's a sign in his waiting room, and it says, if you're not called by the doctor in 15 minutes, you report him to President Broadhead. And it took Jesus 3 days to get over to resuscitate his friend Lazarus. I preach this sermon hesitantly because I know there's somebody here today that knows firsthand those long late night vigils, that yearning that is expressed in Psalm 130. My soul waits for the Lord. More than watchmen wait for the morning, my soul waits for the Lord. There's somebody here who knows that. The psalm ends, 130 ends by saying, with the Lord there is kindness and redemption. Yes, but not yet. Well, I got sick last year, and I was sure it was a dreaded swine flu or bird flu or some other bestial pestilence was afflicting me. And it dragged on week after week, and I was impatient. I had important things to do and places to go, things to do that you cannot do if you're coughing your guts up and your nose is running. And when I finally got an appointment with Dr. Kelly, he examined me and he gave me the diagnosis, quote, it appears you have whatever is going around. And when I was free of fever and back on the mend, I was complaining to a friend of mine, a retired campus minister here at Duke Chapel, about the injustice of my illness. And he asked me, what do you think God was attempting to teach you in your illness? What? I'm supposed to learn something from my pain? What? I'm supposed to grow closer to God even in illness? What? You trying to tell me that you think God, that I was so afflicted because God was trying to teach me something about my mortality and my finitude that I've spent my life avoiding? Is that what you're trying to say? One day, we shall know. One day, we shall see for sure. Jesus present, now, the kingdom of God in its fullness. Though maybe not as soon as we might like.
Please stand and let us confess our faith together. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
Please be seated. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Holy and eternal God, you are our dwelling place for all generations, and from everlasting to everlasting, you are God. 1,000 years in your sight are like a day. We praise you that we can be sure that your love is steadfast and your grace is enduring. We are grateful, O God, for your constancy. When we are impatient and our desires are immediate, help us to wait for you, knowing that you are at work in our lives and in the world. When we long to see evidence of your presence fixing the brokenness around us and within us, give us patient trust, knowing that your timing is not our timing. And as we wait, help us to pray. O God of us all, we pray for this world, our home. We pray for peace in nations filled with violence, uncertainty, and war, asking that you make a way for justice and stability. We pray that elections in Afghanistan will mark the beginning of a new day, that talks in the Middle East would be productive, and that Syria would dispose of chemical weapons. We continue in prayer for those searching for the Malaysian jet, asking that you protect those who search and comfort those who grieve. Lord, in your mercy. Merciful God, we know that violence is not just far away, but is often close to home. We pray for those who are wounded and grieving as a result of the shooting at Fort Hood. We pray for those who live in crime-ridden neighborhoods and fear for their safety. And we remember those who are victims of domestic violence, rape, and incest. Too often, O Lord, violence creeps into places that we expect to be safe. We seek your mercy for those who are suffering, and pray that by your healing presence they would find peace. Lord, in your mercy. Loving God, who is near to each of us, we humbly seek your presence in our own lives. You alone know our private fears, our hidden pain, and our tentative dreams. Work within us, we pray, to renew, rebuild, and reform us as your faithful disciples. Lord, in your mercy. In all things, O God, help us to wait on you, for with you is steadfast love and the power to redeem. We offer our prayers in our Savior's name. Amen. This morning, we have a mission announcement from Janet Zhao, a Duke Divinity School student who also works with the Community Empowerment Fund.
All gifts given to the Community Empowerment Fund today will be spent on CEF's one-on-one work with underbanked, low-income folks in Durham and Chapel Hill, many of whom currently live in shelters or transitional housing. Our members work one-on-one with Duke and UNC student advocates to set and reach saving goals, budget creatively, find employment, move into and maintain affordable housing, connect to community services, and walk towards financial stability. All of our work is built upon relationships of trust, growth, and mutual learning. CEF is a student-driven organization that has been deeply shaped by the Chapel's Pathways program, and we are ever thankful for your support.
All that we have and all that we are is a gift from God. Let us then share what we have to help those in need and to know the joy of giving.
Thank you.
Let us pray. All things come of thee, O Lord, and of thine own have we given thee. We give our gifts, time, and talents. We give ourselves as a thanksgiving to you, from whom all blessings flow. We give thanks for your depth of mercy and for the Spirit of the Lord that rests on us to illuminate our hearts and minds, like with the Department of Psychology and Neuroscience, who probes the mind and seeks to integrate behavioral, social, and brain and health sciences. As we look backward and forward, as we wait, our hearts are a Eucharist before you, and even when we don't know what to say or how to say it, we thank you for the words Jesus taught his disciples, saying, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen." As you sit in the waiting room of life, may the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of the sovereign God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all now and forever. Amen.